minor note in my symphony of downright nasty not niceness. The crescendo of my odious opus. Oh, the wailing and the gnashing of teeth. The bellowing of the bitterly bombed out. It'll be like music to my ears.
Then the Grinch heard a sound rising over the snow. It started in low, then it started to grow.
Huh? Huh?
But the sound wasn't sad. Why, this sounded merry. But it was merry. Very. Every who down in Whoville, the tall and the small, was singing without any presence at all. He hadn't stopped Christmas from coming. It came.
Somehow or other, it came just the same.
Mr. Grinch!
And the Grinch, with his Grinch feet ice cold in the snow, stood puzzling and puzzling.
How could it be so? It came without ribbons. It came without tags. It came without packages, boxes, or bags.
And he puzzled and puzzled till his puzzler was sore. Then the Grinch thought of something he hadn't before.
Maybe Christmas.
He thought.
Doesn't come from a star. Maybe Christmas. Perhaps. Means a little bit more.
What happened then? Well, in Whoville, they say that the Grinch's small heart grew 3 sizes that day.
Let me get the lights working. Maybe Christmas doesn't come from a store. We talk about it every year, don't we? That Christmas is over. Commercialized, that we don't focus on the right things, and it's still true, but that clip makes a pretty powerful statement about how important it is that we focus on what we get out of Christmas and then instead of what we get for Christmas. The Grinch realized, obviously, he couldn't steal Christmas, right? Because it's not about packages and bows. It's not about what people get or give. It's about the message of Christmas. Every year, you can go to Walmart, the mall, Target, Kmart, wherever you want to go. Every year, about this time, there's a frantic rush to buy things. Very few people look like they're enjoying the process. Most people look like they're stressed and as if it is bringing their lives something other than what this time should bring their lives. In fact, wouldn't it be hard for you to know that if somebody was out buying you a gift, that that gift came out of stress and debt instead of joy and appreciation? But many, many times the gifts we receive and even the gifts we get or give are given because we think this is a lot of what Christmas is really about. Every year I wish I could focus more on what I get out of Christmas than what I get for Christmas. It's really not that I focus much more on what I get for Christmas anymore. I don't really do that anymore. We have four kids. We don't get much for Christmas. But it is hard to challenge myself to think about what can I get out of it, out of the message, out of what the meaning of this season is. And the message of Christmas has some absolutely amazing, I would say without any speculation or overstatement, that they are life-altering messages. They can change us. They can change us here and now, not just for an eternity, but also for an eternity, but they can certainly have a present impact on our lives at this very moment, this very stage in your life. No matter what it is or what your circumstances is, the messages of Christmas that are inherent in it and what God did and why God did it are powerful and life-altering in and of themselves. Last week we said this, that the first thing we can get out of Christmas, the first thing we can get out of the message is the fact that God declared, that Christmas declares that God loves us perfectly and did love us perfectly when we were at our worst, when we had nothing to offer, when we were literally, the Bible says, we were dead and helpless in our sin. And that assures us He's never going to fail to love us in the future. If God loved us at our worst, now that we've been adopted into His family as followers of Jesus, if indeed we've made that decision, then there's never going to be a time where we have to wonder. And the good news is this, if you're here today and you've never made that decision, if you've never been adopted into God's family through faith in Jesus, you can know this, that God already loves you perfectly. You don't have to do anything. You can't do anything is the real message, but you don't have to. God's not demanding that you do. He loves you perfectly right where you are, right like you are. He offers no mandate or ultimatum and say, if you do this, I do this. God's love said this, I love you already. I love you enough to take the initiative. I love you enough to pay your debt. I love you enough to come and become one of you. That's the first message of Christmas, that God loves us perfectly when we're at our worst, so we know that He's going to love us forever and always. Do you know the most basic reason we end up feeling pressure? We end up feeling obligation to get gifts for so many people. And I heard a statistic of how many people buy gifts for people they don't even like. That doesn't sound very churchy or Christmassy, but it's a reality. And it's a huge percentage of people that are out buying gifts for people they don't even like. Why would we do that is the question. Why would we feel a pressure or an obligation to do that? And I want to contend to you, they didn't say this, but I think the answer is this, is that we feel a massive amount of pressure to pursue acceptance and respect and appreciation from everybody around us. That is, we do not like the thought of somebody thinking low of us. We do not like the thought of somebody, even somebody we don't like, not appreciating us or valuing us. So we're always in the pursuit of somebody caring about us. I think that's at the heart of why most people are doing strange things like buying expensive gifts for people they don't talk to all through the year. It's not because of just a mild obligation. It's because of something deeper and relational that's going on in us. See, we're all prone to living in pursuit of being accepted. Everybody's prone to live in pursuit of being cared about. And that's not a bad thing. That is a good thing. In fact, I would say that that's something that has been instilled in you by God, to be loved. To be loved is perhaps the greatest relational need any person is ever going to have. You share it with me, I share it with you. We don't just want to be loved. You were designed because in a way that you need to be loved. That's part of what it means to be human. The desire. Now, I would say that we are the only living form that has that need, but my yellow lab named Trixie, I think she has a need to be loved. Maybe not inherent in the species. We'll see. The desire and the need to be loved are good things. God put them in you. They're there for a reason. And the basic reason is so that you would turn to God to have that need met, to experience fulfillment of that need. But here's where things go wrong. Instead of going to God to meet this need to be loved, we stop so far short. And then what do? We look to other people to meet that need that God has placed in us so that we would turn to Him and have the need met. But we don't do that. We turn to each other. So much so do we turn to each other that we buy gifts for people that we don't ever talk to. I would contend to you that's at the heart of the whole thing. How somebody's going to respond to us if we don't send them a card? How is somebody going to think of us if we don't get them a gift? What are other people going to think about us? And it's all about this need to be, it's not just social, it's being socially appropriate. It's not just etiquette. At the heart of this is your need to be loved, your need to be cared about, your need to be respected and accepted and appreciated. Good stuff. But we're looking in the wrong places to have the need met. And Christmas highlights that. As love deficient people, which we all are, born with a love deficiency, begin to look to other love deficient people to meet a need to be loved, then we start settling for something dangerous. It's called conditional love. And then we put conditional love in the place of unconditional love, and we're never stopped pursuing it because it's conditional. It's like drinking salt water when you're really thirsty. It may taste good going down, but it does not satisfy. Conditional love, I would contend to you, is the best you're ever going to get from another person. You and I cannot meet the need for unconditional love. We can grow in that direction. We can absolutely move in that direction, and we should, as we become more and more like Jesus, grow in our capacity to love somebody selflessly. But I'll tell you at the very outset of this message that even the people I love the most in my world, I will tell you I love conditionally. That is, I'm not trying to manipulate them, but there are times when I don't love them based on how they behave in my life. I don't respond to them. Sometimes I snap at my children. Why do I do that? Is that love? No. Sometimes I don't think of my wife before I think of myself. Is that perfect love? No. I don't do it perfectly. And if they're depending on me, and if I'm depending on them to meet my true love need, it's never going to get met. We're going to keep dancing the dance. We're going to keep playing the game. And we're going to keep doing it. And I'm not saying that's wrong. We should do that. We better love each other. But if that's all we've got, we will enter into a vicious cycle of unconditional love. You love me if I love you, and we'll play the game for the rest of our lives. And we never get the need met. So we build relationships on the basis of an exchange that we make. Now, this is going to sound like psychology, and it's not. Just follow me here for a minute, because it sets up everything we need to talk about today. Basically, we set up relationships on the basis of this exchange. That is, if I behave a certain way, I get a certain response. I give you a gift at Christmas. Then you tell me thank you. This is very overly simplified, of course. But you haven't spoken to me, and I haven't spoken to you for 364 days. We get a sense of, oh, I'm appreciated. Now, let's go further than that. I behave a certain way in my marriage, and I get in a certain response. I behave a certain way as a father. I get a certain response. I behave a certain way as a pastor. I get a certain response. And I behave this way because I want the response. I like the response. I am not saying that is wrong. I'm saying that's an inborn need. God has instilled that need to want the response. I want and I need your love and affirmation. You need mine, and we need each other's. What I'm saying is that is not the source. That's not the end. It's not the ultimate. That's not going to satisfy us. So when we stop there, here's what happens. If the response I get, whether it's acceptance, whether it's affirmation or respect or appreciation, is basically a trade for what I give you, if we boil it down to a trade, I'm nice to you, you're nice to me, and then we get along, guess what happens when I can't make the trade? Guess what happens if my whole relationship with you is based on the fact that I'm nice to you because you're nice to me? And then one day, whatever the reason is, I can't make the exchange. I'm not nice to you. You're going to still be nice to me? Well, that depends on how not nice I am to you now, doesn't it? You can say, well, I would still love you, Pastor. I appreciate your faults, and I love you anyway. Now, wait a minute. That's one thing if I forget to post a happy birthday posting on Facebook when it's your birthday, right? You could overlook that and say, well, he's busy. He's got a lot of stuff going on. What if I don't show up at the hospital when you're sick? You could use this for anybody. I'm not excusing my bad behavior, so I just get to do it right here, okay? But you say, well, okay, well, that might hurt my feelings, but I get over it. But what if I'm rude to you? Well, maybe you're having a bad day, right? Okay, what if I lie about you in a disparaging way? Well, you going to love me then? What if I do something that causes you physical harm or messes up a relationship in your life? What if I do something that's really hard? How far do I have to go to break the conditional love? All I'm doing is pointing out the road that we're on is the best we can give is still conditional in most senses. And we grow in that. There's a spectrum of how we mature in loving each other. I'm not saying it's shallow, and I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm just saying the best we have to offer will never meet the real need that we've got. Because I can break it. The exchange that we're doing, the dance that we're doing, has a breaking point. And you know that. And we don't like it. And we pretend that it's not there, but it's there. There's a point at which you're not going to treat me the way I want to be treated if I don't treat you the way you want to be treated. There's a point at which that's going to happen. It may be way down the road, and for most of us, it's pretty far down the road. That is, if I don't say hi to you in the hallway, you're not going to just get your dander up or vice versa and not talk to me for a week. But some people do, don't they? Why? Because it's conditional. Because everybody in here has a love deficiency, a need that we can't meet for each other, and we shouldn't expect other people to meet the need. Now, side note, this could get very thrown out of sorts. We need to love each other, right? We need that. We don't need to depend on each other to meet the ultimate need of love that we have, because there's only one person that can do that, and you know where we're going with that. All right, let's flesh it out a little bit further. That if I don't meet your need, then you don't meet my need. Essence is at the essence of conditional love. We don't like to think of it as conditional love, but if your love for somebody else has a breaking point, it's what is that other than conditional, right? Now, I would tell you that my wife and my children are the people that I could love the most unconditionally. But while I may have a sentiment in me, here's the reality. While I'll love them in my heart, there would be a point at which my own family could hurt me enough that I would pull back in self-preservation at some point and not treat them like they deserve to be treated. But here's the cool thing. Here's the cool thing. Before you think I'm a crazed lunatic for saying stuff like this, here's the contrast. There is not such a point with God. There's not such a... We don't want to think of ourselves like this. Now, I'm not saying I would ever, ever bail on my family at all. I will love my kids because they're my kids. I will care for them. But there may be a point which they could break the relationship and we wouldn't function in a healthy way because of something they've done. And because I couldn't stand under the pressure. I couldn't continue to make the exchange if it's just one-sided. But there's never a time, because that's always, there's never a time when God's going to do that. Now, I need you to soak that in and not think that I'm talking about that our love is all shallow and frivolous. It's not. And the more you become like Jesus, as you grow in Christ's likeness, the less of a propensity you will have to love conditionally. I'm going to tell you right here and right now. My ability to love people unconditionally has grown enormously. Has grown enormously over the last decade. Why? Only Jesus. And here's the other part. You might not like this part. It's experiencing in relationships the need to love unconditionally. That's the part I don't like. It's the process of growing in unconditional love always takes us through the need to love unconditionally. That is, I'm only going to grow in that respect when I have to make the exchange or extend love when it's not reciprocated. Okay? That's pretty hard stuff. Think about it. My dad taught me a word probably when I was real young. And I don't know why he taught me the word. It's called altruism. Has anybody ever heard of altruistic behavior? It's a biological term. Basically means that a certain animal will act in, will undergo great harm for the benefit of the group. That is, one will die for the many when it has no benefit to the to the one that dies, but it has benefit to the group. You can see this behavior a lot in animals such as deer, or have you ever seen a killdeer who will, it's a one of those little shorebirds actually, that they always nest in gravel parking lots, and I've noticed them since I was a little bitty. But if you get near the nest of a killdeer, it will fake an injury and draw attention to itself. Fan out its wings and its base of its tail, and the base of its tail is rusty red, which is supposed to draw the attention. An incredible design by the father, draws the attention of a predator, and it fakes an injury as it walks away. So it's literally saying to the predator, a coyote, a fox, or a cat, come get me. Now, its ultimate goal is to escape, too. It's not just saying, come eat me. But it is saying, I'll take on the predator. That's altruism. That's a selfless act. We grow in, and I think that's cool that God instilled that in animals, because that's where we're supposed to be moving toward ourselves, is altruistic, selfless, just selfless behavior. When you're looking for other people to meet your need for altruism or selfless behavior, you're never going to find it. It's never going to be fully satisfied. Now, our sinful nature that you have, that I have, that nature in us that says me first, everybody else second, that sinful nature drives us to demand other people love us. But makes us oftentimes unwilling to do the same for them. Now, if we're really honest, and we want to pull the curtains back further than we normally pull them back, we would say, well, I guess there's some merit to that, because sometimes I do things that appear like I love people, but my motive's not right. For instance, the gift that you're going to give to the person at the office that you don't really like, but you feel obligated to, and you don't want other people to think poorly of you or to even know that you don't like that person, so you bring them a gift. If you're just looking at the fact that you're bringing the gift, you go, wow, they're nice. Maybe they like me after all. But inside you're going, you dirty, rotten scoundrel. You took my office space, and you're always brown-nosing the boss, and you're doing these things. And see what I'm saying? If you want to get real honest about our condition, it can be ugly, can it? Why we do what we do often tells a greater story about how selflessly or selfishly we actually love each other. Let me do this. When we're talking about, and I'm setting up, the heart of the message is not hard to get, so I'm not going to spend as long. This is what Andy Stanley calls hooking up the train. I got to hook up the train this morning. That is, if I pull out and start telling you that God loves you unconditionally, how many times have you heard that? The problem is that we don't understand how rare, how non-existent unconditional love really is, except in the Father. So, if we're going to be people who are going to say, let's do this dance of meeting, trying to meet each other's need of unconditional love, when we're love deficient, it's like this. It's, if two neighbors both owe the cable company $100, say they're real good friends, and they meet each other halfway in the yard, and they're both going to say, hey, can I borrow $100 to pay my cable bill? Who's going to get to do that? No, they both have the same need. So can I meet my neighbor's need if I have the same exact need? Can I give him $100 to pay his cable bill if I don't have $100 to pay my own cable bill? Can you meet somebody's love for unconditional love if you do not have the unconditional love to give them? No, you can't. Does that mean that you can't love them in a growing and Christ-like way? Absolutely doesn't mean that. You better and you should, and we're called to. But true unconditional love, church, listen, doesn't have a breaking point in how it responds to people. Because while we were at our worst, that's why we set up last week with what we said, while we were at our worst, while we're hating God, we're literally on the enemy's side, God loved us the greatest. That's unconditional love. And we don't have any hope apart from that kind of love. So what in the world do we do? Is there such a thing as that truly unconditional love among each other? In relative terms, there is, that we can grow in that way, but in pure terms, where a human being can love another human being with no expectation of return, there's a breaking point within us. Now, can someone ever value you? Can someone ever appreciate you? Can someone respect you? Absolutely. But only one person can meet this need. What's amazing is not just that God loves us, but it's how He loves us. And it's this is the essence of the message of Christmas. The value of this season of celebration is in what we get out of Christmas and not just what we get for Christmas. And this is the stuff we can get out of Christmas. I want you to look at Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2 and verse 14. Now, what I'm going to do today is I'm probably going to break a little bit from in our Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. I should know the Gospels, shouldn't I? All right, I want you to stand and let's read Luke chapter 2, verse 14. Let me give you the setting because I'm not going to read it all. This is when the angels have declared the birth of the Messiah, Christ the Messiah, to the shepherds. And then the angel has made that declaration and then a heavenly host breaks forth and declares this truth. It says this in verse 14, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom He is pleased." And on earth peace among men with whom God is pleased. Let's pray. Father, for the rest of this message, I want us to tune in to what You've got to say. I really, really do, God, because I believe You have a life-altering message for us right here and right now. And I pray that anything that is murky, anything that is unclear, anything that seems confusing would become lucid and transparent and easily comprehended. Speak to us now through Your Word. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Now, let me read you one more passage as you sit down. This is the passage on the heels of what we just read. Listen, in 1 John chapter 4, verses 10 through 11 and verses 16 through 19, here's what it says. "In this is love, not that we loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation or the payment or the atoning sacrifice for our sins." Verse 11, "Beloved, if God so loved us," or if God loved us in this way, "we also ought to love one another." Notice that verse. Let me read it again. "If God loved us this way, in this unconditional way, we also ought to love one another in a growing fashion in this way." Now look at verse 16. "We have come to know and have believed the love which God has for us." Isn't that an awesome statement? John says, "We've come to know and believed the love which God has for us." God is love, he says. God is love. And the one who abides in love means to remain in love. The one who abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. Verse 17, "By this, love is perfected or completed with us." By this, what? By abiding in God's love. So that's what verse 17 says. "By this is love's completed with us," or in us, "so that we may have confidence in the day of judgment. Because as He is, as Jesus is, so also are we in this world. There is no fear in love." There is no fear in unconditional, perfect love. Perfect love casts out fear. Because fear involves punishment. And the one who fears is not perfected in love. Not in their capacity to love. It's not talking about being perfected in their capacity to love. He's talking about their being perfected in their comprehension and the reception of love, of being loved. Verse 19, "We love because He first loved us." We love because He first loved us. But we're trying to love so that we can be loved. Isn't that strange? The Bible says the only way we're ever going to love people well is if we know that God loved us first. But we are willing to do this because we're so confused and love is so convoluted in our culture today that we're trying to love to be loved. I love you, so you love me. We do not like to pull the covers back and talk about it that way because it doesn't sound so good when I say my love is conditional. But the fact is, the best you've got to offer is some form of conditional love that progresses, hopefully, in Christ towards selflessness, but it's still conditional. The love that God has for you, church, I'm going to say it over and over and over today, is not conditional. There's absolutely nothing that you could do to dampen God's sentiment towards you or the favor with which He will treat you. There's nothing you could do to cause him to stop being in pursuit of you. Nothing. You couldn't imagine the most vile, heinous act. It would not stop God's, because you were already doing that when Christmas happened. That's why we read Luke chapter 2, verse 14. Notice that the last five words of that verse are very, very important. It says, "Glory to God in the highest, and peace on earth among men with whom he is pleased." The angel announced that before the sacrifice that took place on Calvary, which atoned for our sins, which makes us right with God. So that tells me that God was already pleased with men, which means we had his favor before we did, while we were dead in our sins. You had God's favor while you were on the enemy's side. And we said that last week, but this verse is pretty powerful. It's because of the timing of it. The angel's declaring an eternal truth. Peace on earth among men with whom he is pleased, with whom he is already pleased. God was already pleased with you. That's why Jesus came. See what I'm saying? This is unconditional love. This is true love. And this, when you put our love in light of this kind of love, it just blows it out of the water. It says, why would we ever try to find somebody else to meet our need for love when God loves us like this? I don't know. Probably because we don't get that this love really is this unconditional. It's hard to fathom. It's really hard to fathom. There's a lot of people that think God loves us the most, but not a lot of people that believe that God truly loves us without conditions. But these scriptures make it very, very clear when he says, with whom he is already pleased. You've already had his favor. You've already got his attention. You're already loving, being loved by God when you are dead in your sins, when you're on the enemy's side, when you're actively opposing God, when you're violently opposing him. In every spiritual and physical form, we were decadent, we were horrid, we were decaying spiritually and filthy in every respect, and God was pleased with us. And it's not because of what we did. And it's not even because of our potential, it's because of who we were created to be. And God doesn't fail. God created you to be an object of love, a dearly loved child of his. And he didn't fail. Not even sin could interrupt that process. I want you to notice something else in the John passage. It says that God is love. That's a pretty important three-word statement there. Mind-bending, honestly, because we don't think of love as being an element of or a part of the substance of somebody who exists. We think of love as something we feel or do. But the Bible says that God is love, that it's a part of who he is, that is just as a tree is wood and a lake is water, God is love. I know, it hurts my brain too. It's the composition of his character and who he is. It's the fabric of his reality. This God love naturally overflows from his being because it's a part of his being. It's not something he's trying to do. It's who he is. And that's what real love does. It extends itself for the benefit of others with no expectation of return. So check this out. In light of this, God says, and this is really oversimplification, but we got to get the point. God looks at humanity and says, they may not one of us turn to us, but I'm going to offer the greatest price possible in hopes that they do. Now, I know we're dealing with sovereign knowledge and omniscience and all that, but just this gets the point across. God says, humanity is living in rebellion to me. They hate me. They want nothing to do with me. They don't want me to come do anything for them. But I'm going to give the greatest price I could ever give in hopes that they would return to me. That's love without conditions and no expectation of return. Because he did it anyway. He did it anyway. In the second passage, in that John passage, verse 17 says, by this love is perfected with us, so that we may have confidence that it's God's love. When we are loved by God, it fills us, it completes us, it gives us that which we're in pursuit of. It's the only thing that satisfies our need to be needed, loved, and valued, and appreciated. You can put all kind of nice words on it, and lots of guys don't want to say, well, I want to be loved. Okay, you just put a different word on it. You can talk about being respected or appreciated or valued or having meaning or purpose, whatever you want. The bottom line is you need to be filled with God's unconditional love. And he's the only one that's going to fill it. And he proved that he would do it on Christmas, because on Christmas he gave his son to step into the quagmire and the mess and the filth and the muck and the mire of our world, paying the highest price he could pay when we were at our worst, because of who we were already, not because of what we could do. We are his dearly loved children. Whether we experience that relationship or not is up to us, whether we receive the offer, whether we take hold of Jesus or not. So perfect love extends itself. It says this is, love is perfected in us through this. And verse 18 goes on to say, there's no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. When you receive the perfect love of God into your life, you don't ever wonder, once you get this, you don't ever wonder, is God going to reject me at some point? Listen, if you're sitting here wondering today, if you've done something in your past, or if you could do something in your future that's going to make you a second-rate citizen in God's family, you have not come yet to understand that this love is powerfully, profoundly, almost in a mind-boggling way, unconditional. You could never do it. You can't threaten, crack, or diminish God's love for you in any way. I promise you. So Romans 5:8 says again, God proves his love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. When did he do it? While we were still sinners. He proved it. He proved it. Another translation says demonstrated it. Another translation says showed it. He put it on display so there would be no doubt. So that while you're still a sinner, he said, if he loved me then, how is he not going to love me now? That's Paul's argument. He's going to love you. He does love you, and he always has loved you. God accepts us and places the highest value on our lives apart from anything we do or say. But because we're trapped in this maze of conditional love, that's very hard to understand. Because we know inherently that we have a breaking point. We know inherently that at some point we may not be willing to make the exchange for other people. We know at some point somebody could do something so harmful, so hurtful to us, while we still may have a sentiment or affection of love for them, we would not have the same relationship. The relationship would change. I would move back. Here's the deal with you and God, is that you may do something that causes you to move back, but it will never, ever cause God to step back. In human relationships, there's always a point at which I may step back, probably out of necessity, to protect myself from further hurt, but not for God. He doesn't need to, because he is love. So, verse 19 says the concluding statement. We love because he first loved us. If you would permit me to expand that thought, because I think it's inherent in the text, you will hear me say this. We can only love each other when we realize God has loved us first. We can only love each other when we go to God to meet our unconditional need for love. We can only truly love each other or love God back when we first let God love us unconditionally. When we first let God meet our need for unconditional love. We love because he first loved us, not so that he will love us. Friend, I want to ask you today, be honest with yourself. Are you loving God today? Are you here today? Are you studying your Bible today? Are you praying today? Are you going to put a tithe in the plate later today? Are you going to sing today? Because in the deepest recesses of your heart, you think somehow you've got to earn his love or keep his love or maintain his love or walk some kind of love tightrope for him, because that's how everybody else is in your life. Have you ever checked that out in your heart? Because you can be free from that. Did you know you can be free from that? You can live in response to love and not in pursuit of it. I know it's a foreign concept for most of us, this kind of love. But you can live in response to unconditional love and not in pursuit of it. It's already yours. Just so many of us have treated unconditional love like it has a condition, and it doesn't. And God knew that would be hard for you. God knew that. So he put his love on display. So many people will say, well, God wanted to forgive us. Listen to this. If God wanted to forgive us, why did he have to? Couldn't he just declare it? Couldn't he just from heaven made a decree? I forgive you. I love you. And the whole world would have heard it. He could have written it on Mount Rushmore. Maybe we wouldn't have the statue faces. We just have God inscribed with his fingers, I love you unconditionally. Now, think about it. If God just says it, how much harder is that going to be? We still struggle with it when God put it on display. We don't have it on Mount Rushmore. We have it on Mount Calvary. A cross with his son, hung bleeding and dead. Who did it? We did. You would think at that point, at the rugged cruelty and the horrific nature of the cross, which we're all sharing the guilt of, that God would have said, if that's what you're going to do with my best gift to you, the deal is over. If you're going to rip the skin off of my son, if you're going to spit in his face, if you're going to pull his beard out, if you're going to mock him, I don't need you. But he didn't. Check this out. Because if that was happening, Jesus said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Unconditional love for you, for me. So, what does that mean? You get to live in response to being loved instead of living in pursuit of being loved. How does that change your world? Because now you don't have to treat other people as if they are needed by you. Now wait, let that soak in. Do you want to be needed or do you want to be loved? Husbands, do you want your wife to stay with you because she needs you to take out the trash? Or because she loves to see you every morning no matter what you're doing? Wives, do you want your husband to stay with you because he needs you? He needs your income that you provide? He needs you to make sure that maybe this is stereotypical sounding, but it's very common. To make sure you don't wash the reds with the whites? We do need that. I'm just telling you. I do. Or do you want to be loved? Do you want them with you because they love you or need you? If you receive the unconditional love of God through Jesus into your life, and I'm talking to Christians, I'm not talking about be born again, I'm talking about understanding God's love and for what it really is, it really truly is unconditional. If you'll let it flow into your life without condition, you can begin to live in response to it. That means that changes how you relate to other people. You can begin a journey of loving people without conditions. Yeah, it's going to break, and you're going to have some conditions, but you can grow more and more like this. You can see this example all through history with Mother Teresa and all kinds of people who began to grow in this realm of unconditional love. We saw two here as missionaries to Southern Asia who give their lives without condition. They're not getting a lot out of it, but they're growing in the love of Christ likeness. You can do that for each other. You can do that in response to other people. What I'm telling you is when you receive the unconditional love of Jesus into your life and you begin to live in light of it, it changes your relationships with other people and you begin to treat them not as commodities to meet your need, but as somebody that you are there to love in an increasingly selfless way. Now, here's the other thing is God's unconditional love sets us free from this impossible task of living in pursuit of his love. I don't know this because I don't do research and stuff like this. I just observe and I listen and I pay attention to people as I minister, as I pray, as I counsel. But I think it is a rampant problem today that somewhere in the back of our minds, we know theological truth in the front of our mind that we're loved unconditionally for this. By grace we've been saved and da-da-da-da-da-da-da. We could articulate the argument, salvation's by grace, and we would say God loves us unconditionally. But I think in the back of our minds, we have such a hard time comprehending truly unconditional love that we're still thinking, we're still doing things as if God somehow could ever be displeased with us. And if you're thinking, well, if I do that, now I'm not saying that God doesn't, that he loves everything you do and calls it all roses. I mean, you know, if my dog makes a mess, you know what I mean, in my living room, I don't go in and hug my dog and say, thank you, that smells wonderful. You know? And I'm not saying God does that with your sin, but I'm just saying it doesn't have a bearing on his favor towards you or how he's going to treat you. Because listen, what does God do to those he loves? The Bible says he disciplines them. Why? Because he loves you, not because he's mad at you, because he loves you. Did you know God is going to correct you because he loves you? Would you ever, ever not do that for somebody that you loved? If your child or if your parent or your friend was going to have a tragic accident and you had some way of saying you're wrong, this is the wrong choice, you would obviously intervene, wouldn't you? Of course, because love does that. There's nothing you can do to change the unconditional love. You can live in response to God's love. That is freeing. That's freeing. So if God, listen, if God says, hey, why don't you take your family on a trip this weekend and you are living like God's love is conditional, you say, well, if we don't go to church, what do you think God's, is that good? What are other people going to think of us? What's God going to think of us if we don't go to church? Really? First of all, you can't go to church. You can't. You can come worship with the church, but you can't go to church. Take church to the campground if you'd like, to a hotel, or on a trip. But you can't go to church or to a deer blind. Hey, I'm serious. Golf course? I'm not saying you just don't value a worship service, because I think if you're living in response to unconditional love, you love this stuff. Who doesn't want to come celebrate this stuff? That God loves us unconditionally. It's all just multiplied by the people that are here. It's awesome stuff. But what I'm saying is, if God says, hey, go take care of your family. Hey, go minister to this person. And it's on a holy day and you feel like you can't go, you don't get it. You don't get that God's love is not based on your performance for him. It's not. And it never will be. You can live in light and live in response to it. We love God only because he loved us unconditionally. I don't care if you've had an abortion, a divorce, or you've committed theft, or you hate somebody, or you're addicted to pornography or cocaine. Doesn't matter. Or if you're dressed up nice today and you're carrying a Bible, you can quote 42 verses on the spot. God loves you the same. The people that we are prone to hate today in the Middle East, did you know that God loves every single one of those people? He loves them enough that Jesus would die for them. And I think one of the reasons we hate them is because we know we have the same propensity deep down in ourselves. And we don't like it. Jesus equated our simple hatred of each other with murder. Didn't he? The answer is yes to that one. If you even say raka to your brother, he equated to murder. If you even look at a woman with lust, it is adultery. The propensity is in our heart. The great news is, he loves you anyway. Here's your step that I want you to take. One of the greatest freedoms that comes from being loved without condition is having the freedom to stop hiding and posing and pretending for other people. You know this? I heard a youth pastor say this one time. He said most of the teenagers he knew were functionally schizophrenic. Functionally schizophrenic. And here's why he said it. Is they have one way that they've learned to behave, a mask and a pose to put on at school. They behave an entirely different way around their parents and their family at home. And yet when they go to church, they have a whole different front. And when they get by themselves in their bedroom, functionally they say, who am I? Which one of those three people am I? But I think that carries on into adulthood. And what I'm telling you today, the unconditional love of God says you can just be who you are, warts and all. Because it doesn't change God's love for you. And we can learn to not let it change our love for each other. So I'm going to ask you to take a chance. And this is your growing and going step. Take a chance. Be the real you. What is one way, one venue in which you're posing? You behave a certain way in your G2 group? It's not real. It's not authentic. Something you're hiding. You got too much debt. Got a bad marriage. Got a child that's wayward. What are you hiding? And how can you just take one step of coming clean and being vulnerable and being the real you with somebody else? How can you do that? Now, the flip side is if that you're the one that someone's being vulnerable to, the challenge for you is to be like Jesus and to love them anyway. Your challenge is to be real. Unconditional love gives you that permission. That's the kind of church that we are and are becoming and want to become all the more. That's what unconditional love does. That's the message that the Grinch got on top of that mountain that night, right? Remember when he fell down? Did you understand? He said, I'm feeling. I want us to feel what's real. Let's pray. Father, I know my words are a mess. My thoughts are jumbled. But I truly sense your Spirit speaking to your people and that you love them enough to work through my inabilities to communicate. Now, set us free. At least begin the journey of setting us free to becoming more and more and more like Jesus in this regard. But we'll only do this when we really understand and we really accept that your love is profoundly unconditional. It's not a license to sin. In fact, that's the last response anybody would naturally have to truly unconditional love, because it completes us, it perfects us, and it satisfies us. That's what John says. So set us free today. And we love you. But Father, we are mindful right now. We only love you because you loved us first. In Jesus' name, amen. Just got to let that soak in. Listen, I ran that concept by our elders. I ran it by a trusted friend at a counseling center who has a PhD in this stuff. And I didn't shoot from the hip. I worked hard to make sure what I was telling you was sociologically and theologically correct. And I believe it is. I really believe it is. So, if it's truth, what do you need to do? That's what this next couple minutes is about. Just to begin to think, what do I need to do about that? How does that change me? Does that change about how I'm living in relationship to people and in relationship with God? So just take a couple quiet minutes to do that, okay?